Morning Scramble is presented by Wildlife World Zoo and Aquarium.
You ever lean across the counter at the airport and have one of the people from the airline say, "No, I'm terribly sorry. In order to do that, you have to give us another $11,000. Or no, we're bumping you from the plane and you're never allowed to fly again." I mean, sometimes it seems as if there's that kind of pressure and that the power is totally in the hands of the airline. That may be true unless, of course, you happen to be a close personal friend of an attorney who can represent you when it comes to any problems that you have, like, for example, Tim McCulloch, co-managing partner of the Phoenix Law Office of Gordon and Rees LLP. Do flyers really have any recourse? I mean, even with you, Tim.
No, not very much. It's the airlines have all the power. Even when I fly myself, I find myself at the mercy of airlines, so I have to pick which airline I fly very
carefully. I love hearing an attorney saying, "I'm as helpless as the rest of you."
Fortunately, I do a lot of business aviation work, and so every time I go through a TSA line or I deal with an airline and they treat people like that, I just think, oh, it's good for my business. It's good for my business because people would rather charter airplanes than deal with walking through TSA lines or dealing with their airlines and having their flights suddenly canceled and realize I'm going to be sitting in this airport for another 3 hours. It's interesting. Now, there is a passenger's bill of rights. I don't know if most people, I don't think, are aware of the passenger
bill of
rights.
Oh, I'm aware of the fact that we have the bill of rights. I don't know that the airlines necessarily have read the passenger's bill of rights.
They have very, very closely because they are now starting to implement policies to make sure they don't run afoul of the bill of rights. For instance, an airplane can't be parked on the tarmac for more than 3 hours without incurring the cost of the bill of rights. So what airliners will do is they'll park the airplane out on the ramp for 2 hours and 53 minutes, then they'll just cancel the flight. So all of a sudden you end up, okay, so you didn't sit in the ramp for 3 hours, 20 minutes when you may have left. You go 2 hours, 53 minutes, and your flight gets canceled and you'll get to take the next flight.
Excuse me, I get to do what passengers do. Oh, I can't believe it. And when you hear about prior, perhaps, to the Bill of Rights, or maybe yesterday, planes remaining wherever it is that they can remain in order to avoid recriminations for 8, 10, 11 hours, and sometimes with no beverages and no toilet service.
Well, there's a great story about the best story I've heard lately was these folks who were supposed to fly to Shanghai, China. 13-hour flight took 3 days, and they ended up in Anchorage, Alaska, two broken airplanes.
Well, okay, but can we call?
$12 meal vouchers.
Can we call Tim? Can we call Tim McCulloch and get some kind of recourse?
When I read through the story, it appeared to me that the airline worked very hard to stay within the passenger's bill of rights. So they would give you your $12 meal voucher. They would put you up in a hotel. But you're still spending 3 days when you're supposed to be going to China. You spend 3 days in Anchorage, Alaska. People throw up their hands and quit.
Or they just throw up.
Oh, yes, they definitely do that. So to me, it seems pretty toothless to the passenger's bill of rights. It's just airline flying just isn't as fun as it used to be.
If I'm on JetBlue,
okay,
who at one time had a pretty good reputation for bringing all kinds of technology into the cabin and
right,
so on, and then, of course, then the captain went wacko. We're sympathetic to anybody who has psychological problems. He didn't get on the plane and decide to do that.
Right.
What kind of recourse do passengers have when it comes to that kind of terrifying experience?
You know, hopefully JetBlue's offered them some refunds for not having made it to the airport. The passenger's Bill of Rights requires that, but I don't think you're going to have too much recourse because the only thing you were really damaged about is probably you got scared out of your wits. Is I would think that was a very
I may carry that
experience
with me for a while.
Yes, but your chances of running into another captain who's going to go completely insane are probably very, very, very low, I would think.
The chances of running into an extraordinarily aggressive TSA employee, however, are higher than that. And I don't know. It just seems to me that you have those two arguments. One is, I would rather be patted down aggressively or having my child in a wheelchair, as happened recently, patted down, or having my grandmother patted down. I would rather do that than the alternative of having lax security.
You know, it doesn't. That, to me, TSA doesn't provide those particular options. I don't know if you've seen the recent story about the fellow who was able to beat those backscatter machines with, you know, a piece of metal.
I think this big.
And he was able to hide it on his body because of the screening mechanisms that they used. He was able to hide that piece of metal on his body and go through two different backscatter machines. They didn't pick it up. He could have hidden a firearm, a knife. So from my perspective, I think TSA is security theater. It really doesn't provide very strong security at all. So you're dealing with the invasiveness that you're discussing, grandmothers getting patted down, nuns getting patted down. But on the other hand, you're not getting the security that we really need.
Is the security the same around the world now? I'm talking about the Western world now. Let's not talk about African airports and some of the other places where we've heard horror stories. But in London and Paris and Brussels and the other major locations for an enormous amount of air traffic, is it the same? Do they have the equivalent of TSA?
They do. Most countries do. Probably the A-plus team is the airport at Ben Gurion, which is in Israel. Mm-hmm. And they actually don't have backscatter machines. They don't use backscatter machines. They don't require people to remove feet, wear anything. What they tend to do is they use a interview process. And so everybody who goes through that airport goes through an interview process one-on-one with the person. Sometimes there are pat-downs, but it's the invasiveness of the interview process. I'm not sure that would work in the United States.
I've been through it. We showed up 4 hours in advance of a flight on El Al. The thing that was most impressive to me is what is still true. They've still never had an incident with El Al.
Correct. And so they've just based on interviews and very, very well-trained people.
The private plane that just went down here in the valley, I was told, at least in the news, that it was some kind of an experimental plane.
It was.
And that could have been even more serious than it was if it had crashed into a populated area.
Correct, yeah. It was a RANS S-12. That's an experimental. Those are generally kits that are purchased by private individuals who then build them in hangars.
Yeah, but can you fly a kit plane over Sun Devil Stadium, for example? Are there any restrictions?
Yes, but it's not because the airplane's kit-built. You can't fly over Sun Devil Stadium when there's a bunch of people there as a result of security concerns, mm-hmm. So you can't fly any type of airplane. But anywhere you can fly a readily manufactured airplane, you can fly an experimental
airplane. Finally, what should we know in order to fly more safely and more serenely?
Pay attention to what's going on around you. That is to be safe, pay attention. Watch the briefings. I watch the briefings every time the flight attendants give them so that I put it into my subconscious. So if anything happens, I'm ready to react. I watch too many people sit there and not pay attention to the safety briefings. Do you know where the door is? Things like that you can look out for yourself because TSA is not really doing it for you, and I'm not sure the crews are.
I thank you very much. I hope you'll come down. I hope not because of anything in the news, but just in order to make us feel better. And if your TSA pat-down person has two small, tiny punctures on the side of her neck, please ask for someone else. This is Pat McMahon. This is The Morning Scramble.